There are those who undervalue the penal battalions. But they should consider this. Should a man who has wronged the Emperor be allowed to wrong him further? For each man executed is a man who can no longer serve, and to fail in service to the Emperor is the greatest of sins.
Loyalty is a trait that defines the heroic Primarchs who refuse the temptations of chaos. Each Primarch weighed the cost of betraying their Imperium by clashing blades and bolters with their brothers. For some, the Imperium would be secondary yet compatible of their true allegiances, whilst for others their allegiance to the Emperor would be unshakable. But there is only one Primarch whose loyalty is truly ironclad, with no hesitation to reject the poison chalice of chaos. Though seen by many of his brothers as a butcher of men, he would nonetheless be the Emperor's greatest executioner and loyal servant, the Wolf King of Fenris, Leman Russ. The young Primarch would land on the icy death world of Fenris, his incubation pod plummeting into the flank of a vast mountain. Despite the harsh weather, the infant would be found by a she-wolf, a gigantic Fenrisian thunderwolf. Despite its ferocious nature, the wolf would nurture the child and raise it within its wolf pack, a third child to raise alongside its own children, the male wolves, whom would be known as Freki and Geri. During the season of Hellwinter, the child and the wolf pack would scavenge for food within the territory of Thengir, King of the Russ. Escaping with their food, the king would send a raiding party after the wolves, armed with poisonous arrows and blades of sharpened steel. The child would attempt to defend them, being injured trying to protect his adoptive mother and killing dozens of men with his bare hands. The she-wolf would die, but the tribesmen of the Russ would realize the creature bearing its fangs to be a small boy and lower their weapons. The child would be led to their king, and with his brothers Freki and Geri at his side, the chieftain would see great potential in the young boy and order him to be given a place within his household. The boy would learn to laugh and to sing and understand his human traits. Even at such a young age, he would learn to speak and master the battle techniques of axes and swords. With this, he would be named by the king, Leman of the Russ. His exploits would be legendary on Fenris, said to battle entire armies of rival tribes alone, to uproot great oak trees with his bare hands, and to even wrestle the gigantic Fenrisian mammoths of the wilds. With time, the aging king would die, leaving the Russ alone as his successor. Under the rule of their new wolf king, the people of Fenris would thrive, the Russ's deeds even reaching the scouting parties of the Emperor of Mankind. Recognizing these incredible feats to be those of his son, the Emperor traveled to Fenris and disguised himself to venture into the court of the Russ. Meeting Leman, the Emperor would challenge the youth to free trials, knowing the proud Russ would not bend his knee without proof of his acumen. The Wolf King would decide the nature of the challenges. First, the two would indulge in an eating challenge. The Emperor would eat more than any man at the Russ's table, save for the Wolf King. For the second challenge, the two would drink, and by the time the Emperor had drunk his sixth barrel of Fenrisian mead, the two would conclude that there was no more mead to drink. The Wolf King would drain every ounce of alcohol within the feast hall. Failing both challenges, the Emperor would grow angry, decrying the Wolf King as a drunkard and a glutton. Unable to achieve anything more in life, with exception to stuffing his face and bellowing hollow boasts of glory, the Russ would declare his final challenge, drawing his sword from its scabbard. They would face each other in combat, the Emperor throwing his disguise to one side and revealing the splendor and glory of his power armor. The Emperor would not lose, and within an hour of being knocked unconscious by the Allfather's power glove, Leman would admit defeat and swear fealty to the Emperor, with a broken fang jutting from his bloodied smile. Under the tutelage of the Emperor, Leman would learn of the Imperium's star-spanning technologies, understanding the finer points of High Gothic, and earning the Emperor's approval to engage in the Great Crusade. He would meet the only other brother to so far be found during the Scouring, Horus Lupercal, Horus would see his new brother as a savage and treat him with jealousy, masked as disdain. But the Russ would nonetheless seek to ease tensions between himself and his brother. Leman would then be given command of his legion, the Space Wolves, and gifted his thrice-blessed suit of power armor and the legendary frostblade, Mjolnir. Forged with the teeth of the great kraken of Fenris, the blade was said to be strong enough to cleave its ice mountains in two. During the Great Crusade, Leman Russ would gain a reputation as a cunning and fierce warrior. Whilst fighting the Wheel of Fire campaign, the Space Wolves would lose a third of their legion's numbers to the onslaught of orcs. Yet for his efforts, the Russ would be rewarded with the fortress monastery known as the Fang to be built on Fenris. He would also be gifted the Spear of Russ, forged by the Emperor's own hand, which had previously been known as the Dionysian Spear. Though Leman would see little of the Emperor during the Great Crusade, he would be mentored and tempered by Malkador the Sigillite's wisdom, forming between them an unshakable bond. Due to his fiery temper and boisterous personality, the Russ would inevitably clash with his brother Primarchs. During the Doolan campaign, the Space Wolves would fight alongside the Dark Angels. The Doolan planet's leader would verbally insult Leman Russ, stoking his rage, and leading him to vow to kill him personally. As the two legions besieged the throne room, Leman would burst through the doors at the moment where Lionel Johnson, Primarch of the First Legion, would behead the planet's ruler. Denied his retribution, Leman Russ would demand penance from the Lion for his lost honor. The Lion would refuse, leading to the Primarchs to brawl for an entire week without pause. On the seventh day, the Russ would realize the immaturity of their actions and laugh uncontrollably. With the Lion seeing this jest as a mockery to his honor, he would use the opportunity to strike the Russ unconscious. And as the Primarch was roused from his dormant state, the First Legion would leave the system, fueling a feud between the legions which would last into the millennia to follow, with both chapters adopting the custom of their chosen champions dueling for the honor of their Primarchs. Leman Russ would also be sent to retrieve Angron, Primarch of the World Eaters, to be brought before the Emperor. The Red Angel had sought to implant his legion's Astartes with the Butcher's Nail's brain implants, to which the Emperor would demand him to relent, sending his most loyal son to bring Angron to justice. On Malkova, the two Primarchs would clash. The Russ would restrain his martial prowess as he was instructed to by the Emperor. However, this restraint would lead to the Russ being bested by the Red Angel, and his legion would undergo the foul surgeries of the Butcher's Nails. Despite his many rivals, Leman was regarded with respect by some of his brothers, particularly Robute Gilliman, who saw Leman as one of three other Primarchs who always served the Emperor's will with utmost conviction. The others being Rogal Dorn, Sanguinius, and Ferris Manus, regarded by Gilliman as the Dauntless Few. Gilliman even proposed that his Legion of the Ultramarines could win any war outright if only one of those Primarchs, including the Russ, fought beside him. Though as the Great Crusade came to a close, Leman Russ would earn a nickname within the inner circle of his brother Primarchs, the Emperor's Executioner. During the Horus Heresy, Magnus the Red would defy the Emperor's decree of the Treaty of Nicaea. Attempting to warn the Emperor of the betrayal of Horus Lupercal, Magnus would irrevocably damage the Emperor's Webway project, flooding the Webway with demons and dooming humanity to continue traversing the ever deadlier warp and incur its wrath for millennia. Sent by the Emperor, Russ would be tasked with bringing Magnus to Terra to face judgment, but be manipulated by orders from Horus Lupercal, his orders now stating to eliminate the sons of Magnus. Prospero would burn, and the Thousand Sons would be decimated, but Magnus would nonetheless escape into the warp. Leaving Prospero, the Space Wolves would be forced into a rout by the Alpha Legion, taking shelter in the Alaxis Nebula. Surrounded and abandoned by the White Scars Legion when called for aid, Russ would confide with Bjorn the Fell-Handed, stating that blindly serving the Emperor as his executioner was a grave mistake. Vowing to forge his own path, Leman Russ would lead his forces in a desperate last stand against the 20th Legion. The Space Wolves would be saved, begrudgingly by the Dark Angels, and return to Holy Terra. During his time on Terra, Russ would aid Malkador and the Knights Errant in planning the assassination of Horus Lupercal. Dawn and Sanguinius would implore Russ and his Legion to stay on Terra to defend against the oncoming traitor forces, but Leman would resolve to kill Horus himself. With the aid of the Knights Errant, Russ would track the location of the vengeful spirit and prepare to duel Horus Lupercal. With the aid of his rune priests, the Russ would look for a weakness in the Warmaster by traveling to the Underverse, known by the Imperium as the Warp, and venture to Surtur's Door. The Russ would confront the Erlking, a warp entity that collected the souls of Fenrisians who die outside of battle. Before he could be consumed by the Erlking's Vulfen, Leman Russ offered to complete one of four tasks in exchange for his soul. Accepting his terms, the Erlking challenged Leman to drink the damned soul of Amarok's bowl until it was dry. Second, he would wrestle an ancient crone, and finally, move the Erlking's great slumbering wolf. Leman Russ had failed all challenges, but for his fourth, he would need to explain what the challenges he had attempted to accomplish really were. Russ assessed that the bowl represented the changing seasons of Fenris, the old crone was a manifestation of age, and that the wolf was death. The chamber crumbled, and a mirror of Russ dressed in finery would reveal the secret of the Dionysian spear. It held a portion of the Emperor's power and could illuminate the truth to those who were pierced by its tip. The false Russ would impale Leman with the spear, revealing the true nature of the Primarchs. Despairing for a time, Russ would nonetheless emerge from Surtur's Door, with the knowledge that he had the capacity to end the war should he win his duel with Horus. With the aid of his wolf lords, Leman Russ would ambush the vengeful spirit and confront Horus. Offered to join the traitors, Russ flatly refused Horus's offer and fought the Warmaster. Allowing a chance for Horus to wound him with his lightning claw, Russ would use this feint to impale Horus with the spear of Russ. However, due to a moment's hesitation, his strike would land, but not be fatal. Badly wounded, Russ would be dragged from the battle by Bjorn the Fell-Handed and Grimnar Blackblood, as hundreds of space wolves swarmed the Warmaster. Russ would fall into a comatose state as Abaddon the Despoiler pursued the depleted space wolves to the Yarent system. With the aid of Raven Guard Primarch Corvus Corax, the Space Wolves would manage to escape the Yarent system, with Leman Russ passing on the Dionysian spear to Bjorn. The Russ would not be present for the Siege of Terra, and would not return until well after the entombing of the Emperor on the Golden Throne. Returning to Fenris one last time, Leman Russ would host a great feast, then address his sons before embarking into the Eye of Terra.
"Listen but closely, brothers, for my life breath is all but spent. There shall come a time far from now when our chapter itself is dying, and as I am now dying, and our foes shall gather to destroy us. Then, my children, I shall listen for your call in whatever realm of death holds me. And come I shall, no matter what the laws of life and death forbid. At the end I will be there, for the final battle. For the wolf time."
This tale would be retold every 1,000 years by Bjorn the Fell-Handed, the now Great Wolf of Fenris. The Space Wolves would on occasion scout the galaxy in a great hunt in search for their Primarch, but to this day, to no avail. This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Sons of the Praetorian, raise your fists. For in my next Vox transmission, we recall the deeds of Primarch Rogel Dorn.